So congratulations on the Sundance deal.
Thank you.
That's pretty awesome.
Yeah.
Was that a surprise or has it been a negotiation for a long time?
Yeah, well, we've been, yes, it has been going for some time. We just want to make sure that we do the best for the show. And Sundance were the channel who gave us everything that we felt we needed. So, yeah, very cool.
Teresa, obviously on this show, the chemistry between two central characters is so important. What was kind of the process of landing the role and then working with Matthew on building the chemistry? Did you have chemistry tests? How did that happen?
So I was sent the script by my agent. Read it, fell in love with it, wanted to be part of the world. It was like, help me, how do I get this job? So I actually met with Jane Trantor early... when would it have been? Last June, maybe. And I thought she was such an intelligent woman, and the way she broke down the world and the story and the character arc, it was just, it sounded so enticing, and I wanted to be a part of it. So we decided that I would jump into a chemistry read with Matthew Goode, who was already cast. I met him, and from that moment, we were just inseparable. If you ask anyone on the set, we were like brother and sister. We had such a good camaraderie, a really playful energy with each other, and we had fun. So that the chemistry just was already there straight off the bat, and we were each other's teammates, and that was important for a television show of this scale.
So for those that aren't familiar with the books, could you describe what your character is?
Yeah, I play Diana Bishop. She's a historian, she's an academic, she's very interested in alchemy, and she's currently studying, she's a witch as well, but she is denying her heritage. She wants to be a normal person, she wants to live a normal life, and she's struggling against the fact that she does have powers and she is a witch. She wants to deny that part of herself. And then as the story unravels, she's forced to really embrace who she is and become her authentic self, which is the most powerful witch around. And she falls for Matthew de Clermont, and he helps to just, help her to embrace who she is. And I love their dynamic. It's a dangerous dynamic. Interspecies relationships are strictly forbidden, so they end up going on this journey that's really scary, and it can be dark at times, but it's romantic and passionate and adventurous, and there's no other choice. They have to be together. Their love is so strong that they're drawn to each other.
Were you familiar with the books before you took on the role?
I wasn't, actually. I have 3 children, and I haven't read books in a long time. So I think that I missed the boat on reading the books. And then, of course, when the script landed on my doorstep, I jumped into the books. I actually did the audiobooks because I can drive, and when the kids were asleep, I put the audiobooks on because they weren't quite appropriate for my 3-year-old. So I would listen to the audiobooks, and I loved it. It was just this incredibly fantastical, mythical world that I was enticed by and intrigued by, and I wanted to know more.
I loved you in Warm Bodies, and I was wondering, Matthew was cast first, and I love your character in Warm Bodies, and I can see how that type of power can fit into Diana so well. But like, what other characters for Matthew were interesting in like casting him as Matthew? Did that happen? And also Teresa as well. Like, did you look at their past catalog and decide like this is somebody we want to screen test?
I guess on the casting process, we always go with the body of work that's come before. But I think in some respects, more important is how Teresa responded to the material itself, because you really want someone to have that connection and really just get under the skin of the character. And I think it was something that Teresa really picked up on, the fact that, you know, Diana is an academic at heart, but at the same time she's in complete denial of our witches and our power. So it was something that we really wanted to make sure it felt authentic, that Diana lived in that world and she felt like an authentic historian, rather than someone who didn't quite buy into the world.
People who do know the books and love the books, they really love the books. How are you feeling about kind of delivering on all that anticipation for people who have been waiting for an adaptation of these novels?
I think that I can't wait to see the response to it, because I think we've been really, it's been really important to us to make sure that we work closely with Deb to make sure the series is as authentic to the world that she's created as possible. And I mean, as always with an adaptation, you're taking one medium and creating a new medium. And with a novel, you can use the first person narrator to set up and establish the world and set up the characters and the relationships, whereas in a television series, it's so dull to do it that way because it's just reported speech. So we then find ourselves having some conversations with Deborah about maybe bringing characters that were later in the book, bringing them a little bit earlier, so that we set up the worlds, because it was important to set up the witches and the vampires and the demons.
And when you're doing the magic scenes, how do you handle that? And so much of what we see about her in the book is her sense of smell and other things where she feels. How does that come across on screen?
Yeah, it's really interesting because in the book, she's the narrator, so you're hearing through her voice, which you can't really do that in a television show. So it was quite interesting to figure out, how do we explain the magic and her feelings without having narration? I would get on the phone with Deb, or even just over Instagram if she wasn't in town, and I would ask her about specific scenes when it involved the magic, because I think every reader, when they hear, you know, Diana performs Witchwind, they have an idea of how that might look. And I just wanted to know, how do you envision that, Deb? How did you see it coming from her body? Was it just an organic thing? Did it just come out quite rapidly, or does she work on it and it builds up? So it was quite technical, each and every one of the magic sequences. There's a lot of stunt work involved. I didn't have to do a ton of stunts. I did actually some of it with the Satu stuff later on in the story, when I'm captured by Satu. We did a lot of wire work and big green screen, and that was really fun. But Owen Teal was for the Witchwind portion. They brought in massive fans, and they put a huge fan on me, and they put a huge fan on him. These big industrial ones.
It's like almost jet engines.
Yeah, it was. And your hair was flying around. I had tears streaming out of my eyes from the wind. And then he was put on wires and sort of thrown back. And it works really well. So we used a lot of practical effects, which I love, because I've done a lot of things where there's so many CGI sequences, but in our show, I don't know, I mean, we've hardly got any CGI, which is lovely.
I think it's also, just going back to the magic itself, with Owen, for example, in the stunt sequence, it was one of the reasons we decided to build the Bodleian Library at the studios that we have in Wales, because we had to have full control over that space. So it meant that we built a replica of the library within the studio space. And just the detail, I mean, James North, the production designer, has done a phenomenal job. And Deb, who knows the library very well.
It's an exact replica.
Yeah.
So you wouldn't know the difference.
And it's amazing just walking into the space. It's like,
yeah. It was a pity to have to knock it down. Everyone was really sad about that. And same with the other beautiful set pieces too, and the houses that we built. And there was just so much attention to detail. And I remember each and every one of us was like, can James fly over to America and do my house for me? Can he build a set for me? Yeah, and so it was actually sad to say goodbye to some of the sets, but who knows, hopefully season two.
It's true, because I guess, we filmed the series, the majority of it in Wales. And a lot of the interiors we just built in the studio, but of course we go to Oxford and we film on location in Oxford. We go to Venice, we shot in upstate New York, so we've travelled the world really, but filming in the studio just gives us that control that's really helpful, to give a controlled environment to work with.
Are we going to see anything from the second book, or is this all concentrated on the first?
Yeah. Oh, hang on, what about the very last?
I know that No, we won't see that.
We won't see that. Okay. Okay.
Spoiler alert.
Yeah. Spoiler alert. We won't be seeing that.
Season 3 are scheduled. Like
we're developing at the moment.
Okay,
yeah.
Great.
We're we had a writer's room, so we're well just down the line.
This is also news to me. So this is exciting. There's a writer's room. It's all happening. Okay. Great.
Speaking of books, what you have a very old book there. Is
yeah,
that
this Ashmole. Is the Ashmole manuscript. The actual prop that's come all the way from the UK.
I filmed with this. This is, I'll show you the, so you open the clasps and my scene is with while this clasp is now not opening. So, yeah, it's quite beautiful. So my scene is with the alchemical child floating upside down in the vessel. And then there's the moment in the Bodleian Library where she's seeing all the words running over her hands through her body, and she's, you know, running a light underneath the pages, and she can see, you know, it's a palimpsest, so there's words upon words upon words, and then she slams her hand down and she gets burnt by the alchemical child. So she has, and we had, you know, a scar on my hand for most of the series, in the shape of the vessel, which was so interesting, and it's such an amazing scene actually. But to just see the book for the first time was really exciting, and I'd spent a lot of time at Cardiff University looking at old books and handling 17th century books with Deborah and going over it with her and how to touch them and how to be with the clasps and how to flick the pages. I had to split the difference though, because like in real life you take so much time looking at the bindings and the way it's, but on TV the director was like, faster, come on.
But it's also, I think, you know, Deb was so instrumental in helping us come up with this book, so she was involved in the design and the look, and you know, down to the clasps and the thickness of the paper and how translucent it is, because it's still, you know, it's a palimpsest, which means the paper was so rare in this time that they would literally just squeeze all bits of paper together, so they would wash off any ink that was there. But what tended to happen was over time it would come back and you start to see things through the text. So we wanted to make sure that was authentic to what's written in the book and also to reality. So we spent a lot of time.
You guys can look at it. We'll put it here for anyone to look at.
So what have you learned about witchcraft that you didn't know before?
Whoa. Goodness. Well, it's very elemental, I think. You know, she has witchwind abilities, she has witch water, she can time travel, she can light things on fire. It feels boundless, her powers, and I think whenever I've looked at anything to do with witchcraft, it feels like they're very specific, the things that they can do. But in terms of Diana, she's the most powerful witch in the world. She can do anything, and that was quite surprising and exciting to delve into, and I'm really looking forward to seeing how that further develops in the next series.
Yeah, I think it's something that we want to be quite careful though in revealing with the audience, because we want to take the audience on the journey of understanding Diana's relationship with magic and the fact that she's in denial of her powers. And she slowly begins to reconnect with it. So it's almost like a slow burn in some respects.
Mm-hmm.
But you do see the magic come up accidentally when she's...
Which is quite endearing.
Yeah, there's a big story there that will play out for the audience who are watching 6, 7, and 8. It just goes to another level.
Yeah.
Will we see horseback riding in this?
Yes. Yeah, we see. You probably saw a little bit of it in the trailer. It was great because I hadn't ridden horses since I was 12, and then I got to go, we worked with, was it the Devil's Horsemen?
Yeah.
They did
yeah.
like Wonder Woman and all these amazing big films, and they provided the horses for them. So Matthew and I both did about 6 hours worth of horse riding, just training and learning to be with the horse. And then we had a day of filming with them where we got to canter and take them for a trot. And it's funny because then I wrapped The Discovery of Witches, and then I went on to play a jockey in Ride Like a Girl, directed by Rachel Griffiths. And so
I jumped on a horse and I'm like, have you ridden recently? He's like, well, actually, on a discovery of witches. So it was really helpful for me.
I know it's projecting sort of far into the future, but is it very much the fixed plan that it will be 3 seasons, no plans to, say, branch out into original material and beyond?
Couldn't
that?
Couldn't possibly comment.
Interesting.
We think it will be ongoing.
I think that the relationship between Matthew and Diana, the chemistry is incredible. So yeah, watch this space.
Very cryptic.
Are we going to see the scenes where she's in the house and they're getting ready to leave and it's Halloween and there's a special costume involved? Is that actually part of the show?
I mean, I guess it's a spoiler, so we don't really want to, you know, talk too much about it.
Yeah.
Let me just say you won't be disappointed.
Well,
no, it's just with the audience.
Yeah.
It's just how much we want to reveal of that early on, because I think it's a treat and we want to see that.
How tough was it to bring that book to life in the, you know, and not lose what you can't lose because there's people who love it so much?
Can you ask that question again? Sorry, I didn't quite...
I'm sorry. So yeah. You're bringing this book that people love so much to life. How tough is it to not lose specific things, but you know you have to fit it into your series?
Extraordinarily tough, because I think there is such a huge fan base for the show, and we want to be respectful to that audience because they're so invested in it. And invariably there will be some changes, but I mean, we've worked so closely with Deb on it to make sure that she also feels that it will work for her audience, because she knows them so well. So we've been very, very extremely careful.
She was our guiding light, Deb, and you know, like, she just said on the panel, she was like, Deb is not afraid, Deb loves this, so I think we all just have to trust her and her vision, and she'd be the first person to say, no, we need to keep this in here, or oh, it's okay, we can adjust this in this way. But it feels pretty similar to me.
Yeah, but there's little treats in there that I think we've slightly embellished from, you know, so it's not a new character, it's a character that exists in the book, but we've just given that specific character a little bit more story.
Delved further. Yeah.
And, you know, with in full discussion with Deb, of course, and I think the audience are going to go crazy when they see it.